that many, like myself, want a closer walk with God. Ask yourself that question this morning. Do I want a closer walk with God?
Yes.
I wonder how many of you are prepared to witness that you want a closer walk with God. Well, I'm going to give you the opportunity. If you want to witness, do it, stand up. Hallelujah. There we are. That's enough. It only needs two or three. That's all it needs. That's enough. Hallelujah. Well, let me suggest to you that it often happens that we can't get close to God because you and I have already built a barrier. And we may have built the barrier between ourselves and our neighbour. And it could have happened many, many years ago, before we even became a Christian. And, you know, it happens, even in our childhood it can happen. And it results with you and I resisting intimacy. We don't want intimacy with others. We would rather have a shallow life on the surface when it's safe. And often our thoughts go like this. The more intimate I get with you, the more vulnerable I become. And the more that you get to know me, then the more likely is that I'll lose you because you won't want to love me. And if you know me less, then you might love me more. But if you know me too intimately, then you realize how inadequate I am, and how fearful, and how insecure, and how worthless, and how unlovable, and how lonely I am. What a loser I feel. But there are others who are constantly sabotaging the chance of intimacy with others because they're always testing them. We keep people at arm's length, and yet we demand from them what we won't give to them. Yeah. And then when they reject us, we say, well, I told you so. When you trust another person, it can put a shudder through you because you're going to have to take that step of trust. What if they don't accept me? What if this closest person I know doesn't receive what I want to share? And friends, as I thought about it, how can I get closer to God? It came to me that the starting point is that I have to know who I am and who God is. Literally, I have to have a confidence in myself and also in God. And it starts off with me liking myself. And then I have to trust God. And as I thought about this on holiday, my mind went to King David, who we're told was a man after God's own heart. And he wrote Psalm 27, if you want to turn to it, because that's what I'm going to dwell for a moment. Let me read it to you, Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked advance against me to devour me, it is my enemies and my foes who will stumble and fall. Though an army besiege me, my heart will not fear. Though war break out against me, even then I will be confident. One thing I ask the Lord, this only do I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze on the beauty of the Lord and to seek him in his temple. For in the day of trouble, he will keep me safe in his dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of his sacred tent and set me high upon a rock. Then my head will be exalted above the enemies who surround me. At his sacred tent, I will sacrifice with shouts of joy. I will sing and make music to the Lord. Hear my voice when I call, Lord. Be merciful to me and answer me. My heart says to you, seek his face. Your face, Lord, I will seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger. You have been my helper. Do not reject me or forsake me, God my Savior. Though my father and mother forsake me, the Lord will receive me. Teach me your ways, Lord. Lead me in the straight path because of my oppressors. Do not turn me over to the desire of my foes, for false witnesses rise up against me, spouting malicious accusations. I remain confident of this. I will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, be strong and take heart, and wait for the Lord. You see, I don't know whether you noticed it, but David started that psalm by confirming who he is. We've got to know who we are. Now, those who've been coming to Trinity over a number of years, you will know that I'm forever getting you to establish who you are in Jesus Christ. I very often get you standing up and confessing that you're a child of God. You know how often I've done it. We need to let the enemy know. We need to confess it and testify it, who we are. You see, amongst the things that David confessed are salvation, hope, and protection. They're major things in the life of a believer. One might say that David had everything a man could want in his life. It wasn't gained by his own strength. It'd been given to him by God. But then David turns around in that psalm and says he wants something else. And it's his one request. It's the first one of all, in verse 4, to dwell in the house of the Lord. David is saying, oh, I like what I've got, and I want more of it. How many of you can echo that? I like what I've got, but I want more. I want it until I die. It's a lifetime choice, isn't it? I wonder if that's your choice today. David declares that this is not going to be a trial run, or I'm going to dwell with God as long as I feel good about it. David is saying, I want to dwell all the days of my life. John 14. Jesus said this. If anyone loves me, he will obey me. He will obey my teaching. My Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. There's a far better translation of that in one of the modern ones. I like it. It says, we'll be at home with him. Have you ever visited someone's home and felt out of place? You don't want to make too much noise because they live totally different to you. You're not able to relax in their company, which in turn means you can't be yourself. I very often find this. I go to meet families and they're sitting on the edge of their seat. And you can feel it coming back and forward. You see, the word dwell means to linger, or to hang out, if I use a modern expression. You want to feel welcome there. How they live is okay with you. You're not there to change them, you're okay. We need to discover that it's always safe to entrust ourselves to the Lord. Sometimes we think if we're not too agreeable, someone will take advantage of us. But listen, Jesus never ever takes advantage of you. His dwelling place is a place of acceptance. And you and I need to feel safe with him around. Because truthfully, he will never let us down. And knowing that, it allows us to open up to his plan and his direction for our life. You see, if you want to dwell with God, then we need to accept that he is a holy God. A while back, we spent a weekend at Tribeca, and we considered the subject of holiness. Now, most of you will be guessing what I'm about to say, but I'm going to say it again. God is unchangeable, which means he's not going to change to accommodate our problems. If there's going to be any change, then we're the ones who've got to change. The command is for you and I to become holy. And sadly, if we don't change, if we don't try to live, or if we try to live with the problem, then it ends up with you and I having a barrier between us and God. One of the big problems with the Christian church is that we're allowing worldly ways to come in. Anything goes in church. Which means, and this is a sad thing, that often God is not found in his house. Do you know that?
Yeah.
That you can go into a church and God is not present. Isn't that sad? God is not in his house. I was sharing with someone the other week, they asked me, they were asking me about whether we get any requests from the world to use the church. Well, over the years, let me tell you, I've been approached if we will sell carpets. We'll open up the church and have a carpet sale.
Sure.
I've even been approached if we'd have a branch of a bank here.
Oh my God.
Have a choir practice with a worldly choir. The best one I had was recent. I was asked, can we hire a room for a gaming club?
Oh, no.
The answer is no. This is God's house.
Hallelujah.
And there are others who want to apply for lottery money to do God's work in God's house. Sorry, this is God's house, and my God shall supply all our needs.
Yeah.
Friends, I pray that each of us wants to draw near to God, that we want to have an intimacy with him. But I've got some bad news for you. There is no quick path to intimacy with God. Just attending church is not going to do it. So let me explain how we can get to that close place with God. If we're going to develop an intimate relationship with Jesus, we need to understand what it needs. It is the life of Christ reproduced in the believer by the Holy Spirit by abiding in the Word of God. Now notice, no one can do it for you. I'd love to be able to do it for you, but I can't. And neither can the elders, and neither can your neighbour sitting next to you. It's got to be your commitment. It's got to be your effort that brings you to that place of intimacy. All we can do as leaders is encourage you and lead by example. I'm going to do something. really want to be in the God. I want to just look at me. How many of you want to know that intimacy? That's what I'm talking about. That you are so close to God that His presence is overwhelming. That should be every believer. Amen. I didn't have to pray. I didn't have to ask. She just walked into the presence of God. Every one of us should be at that place. Amen? And I'm not showing up. I just felt a nudge from the Holy Spirit to do that. Hallelujah. You see, this is the sad thing. In the Western world, in the church, it's not enough to say that you're a Christian. Because the word Christian has been distorted. If you attend a church, you are classed as a Christian. However, I can tell you this, honestly, I've known people who went to church just to listen to the organ music. I've known others go because they just like listening to the worship group. So it's now got to the point that we've got to put an adjective in front of the word Christian. We've got to say that we're spirit-filled, that we're committed. Or sadly, dare I say it, we're backslidden. They all apply. But in the early Church of Acts, the title Christian was enough.
Yeah.
If in those early days one was called Christian, everybody knew who or what you were. So let me ask you a great truth, or let me into a secret of a great truth. The enemy of intimacy is not outside, it's inside. It's a heart issue. I say it again, it's personal. The church is not the fault. The leaders are not the fault. It's not your neighbor's fault if you can't get close to God. Have a look inside of yourself. How many times have I heard when I've arrived at church, someone said to me, oh, it's a bad week for church. On Tuesday, there's a football international. On Thursday, there's a concert. Or we've also got special programs on the television. Tell me, was there ever a good day for a church meeting? Must the church always take a back seat in favor of every sideshow that blows in the town? Have we just got to take the leftovers? Why shouldn't the other crowd start worrying about us? Why shouldn't the Church of Jesus Christ, who's got all the answers to the world's problem, make such an impact on the world, on the flesh, and the devil, that the devil would start wondering what's happening?
Amen.
And the devil would say, this is going to be a poor week for us this week, because there's revival in town. Church, there's no quick path. When we were born, we didn't become adults overnight. It took time. And so it is for those who are born again. It will take time and experience with the Lord that you can grow and that you can mature. And the truth is, not all of it will be good. I've had some experiences which I wouldn't class as good. But it's been in those experiences that I've grown closer to the Lord during my walk down in the valley of life rather than on the mountaintop.
Yeah, that's right.
You see, once we're born again, the soul of man longs for fulfillment. Many, even in the church, trying to fulfill that longing by being active, They go to every meeting they can. They fill it with seminars. They fill it with different works. But the truth is, our soul will not be satisfied until we become intimate with God. This is what our reborn spirit is seeking. God is calling us now to be intimate. Church, it's time to step out of the soul realm into the spirit realm. Do you understand that? For those who are not sure, we exist on three levels. That's the flesh, the mind and the emotions, that's the soul, and then there's those who are born again, it's the spirit. We need to come into that place of the spirit. Catherine Kuhlman, do you remember that lady?
Yeah.
Read any of her books? Seen any of her programs?
Yeah.
She used to continually say this. Now this is the lady where people, she was up in Canada and America, people used to travel all over the world, and they used to have a queue all around the neighborhood waiting to get into the church because they knew miracles were going to come. Where Benny Hinn got touched. What happened since is up to him, but Benny Hinn got touched, and the Catherine Cooper. And do you know what she used to say? There is more. Oh, that is much, much more. And this is having wheelchairs being thrown away, crutches thrown away, people blind being seen, all amazing things happening, and she's saying, there's more. Are you expecting more?
Yes, yes.
We have been called to dwell in the secret place of the Most High, to gaze upon His beauty, to nestle into His heart, to find home in the midst of His heart. That's the place of intimacy. 1 Corinthians 2. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love Him. I'm sorry, church, but our ears and our eyes and our minds just can't contain all that God wants to give. It's like trying to measure the volume of the ocean with a teacup. I was on holiday recently, as you know, in Lanzarote, and as I stood there, I looked out and I thought, wow, there's nothing between me here and America except ocean. That's how big it is. Thousands upon thousands of miles of water. And do you know the thought came to me? No matter how overwhelmingly vast that ocean is, it's nothing compared to God. In the natural, our senses, that's taste, touch, see, hear, smell, cannot comprehend all of God. But in the spirit world, we're given eyes to see the invisible, the unseen. Ears to hear the inaudible, and minds that conceive the inconceivable. How many of you want to come into that place?
Amen.
I'm fed up with just living in the fleshy world. 1 Corinthians 2 again. But we know these things because God has revealed to us by His Spirit. And His Spirit searches out everything and shows us even God's deep secrets. It's only in moving out of the soul and into the spirit world that we're going to enter into the fullness of intimacy. We are touched. We get touched then in the very deep areas of our heart. Do you know what the call of the Spirit is at the moment? Do you know what the Spirit is saying to me? Do you know what the Spirit wants me to tell you? Know me.
Hallelujah. Amen.
I can sum my message up with that. That's what the Holy Spirit is saying to me this morning. Know me. Know me. Hosea 6. Oh, that we might know the Lord. Let us press on to know him. Then he will respond to us as surely as the arrival of the dawn or the coming of the rain in early spring. Intimacy brings us to a place where God's desires become our desires.
Yeah, that's right.
I love the psalm that says he will give us the desires of our heart. Because in an intimate relationship with God, he's the one who puts those desires in there. Only God can touch your heart. He's the only one who can give you that desire to go and seek and to know him. Our desire for God needs to grow to a place where we can't bear to be separated from his presence.
Yeah.
I've struggled over the last 4 months. Jill has been unwell. She's been out of church. The one thing I regretted about being in Lanzarote, yes, I had his presence personally, but there wasn't a corporate presence.
Amen.
There was no church. Well, there was a church, but it was a waste of time going to it. I'm not being rude. It was just a building. I wanted to be in his presence.
Yes.
And that's the one thing I miss when I go on holiday. Yes, he's with me. I've got him 24 hours a day. But there's something special about corporate presence.
Yeah.
Francois Fenelon said, tell God all that is in your heart, as one who unloads one's heart, its pleasures and its pains. Tell God your troubles, that God may comfort you. Tell God your joys, that God may sober them. Tell God your longing, that God may purify them. Tell God your dislikes, that God may help you conquer them. Talk to God of your temptations, that God may shield you from them. Show God the wounds of your heart, that God may heal them. If you will pour out all your weaknesses, your needs, your troubles, there will be no lack of what to say. Talk out of the abundance of the heart, without consideration. Just say what you think. Blessed are they who attain to such a familiar, unreserved intercourse with God. That's what real prayer is all about. Not rehearsed, special words. Oh, I'm going to say a prayer this morning. It's just pouring your heart into God.
Amen.
Friends, I've got to share one of the major things that stop believers from becoming intimate with God. You're not going to like me for it, but I'm going to share it. A poor self-image. Feelings of shame and unworthiness. Some of oh, I don't think I could hear from God. I'm not good enough. God reminded me this week how the feeling of unworthiness came into being when I was first ordained as a minister. A long time ago. Didn't happen on the night that I was ordained. It happened the next day when I stopped and took stock of what I'd done. And I suddenly realized how many eyes and how much expectation would now be on me. I saw how big the task was and how little I was. And I had to face it. It's a choice that all believers have got to face in their doubts. You've either got to get real good, or you've got to get real with God.
Amen.
And that's the question we keep saying, who am I good enough? And it keeps It keeps getting in the way all the time. Somebody loves me. What? Excuse me. I didn't even know it was on. Stubborn. Only my son, don't worry about it. You see, once the enemy gets hold of that, that you are saying, oh, am I good enough? He's going to hold on to that.
Amen.
And he's going to use it against you. He's going to keep you in those outer courts rather than allowing you to come into the inner courts where God wants you to be.
Yeah.
Friends, get hold of this scripture. Therefore, brothers, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and a living way open for us through the curtain, that is his body, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from the guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. Hebrews 10. Hallelujah. Intimacy is not only an agenda that we impose on someone. Intimacy is two hearts beating as one. God's heart, your heart beating as one. That's intimacy. We need to open up our hearts and let God change them. Many have listened to countless sermons about forgiveness. Yet I say to you, it is still probably one of the biggest reasons that puts a barrier between us and God. Matthew 6, for if you will forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sin, your Father will not forgive your sins. I'm going to jump to the end. Time is gone. How many of you really want to be intimate with God?
Amen.
Well, and let the Spirit of God enfold. And when that happens, you may discover what the Apostle Paul discovered. God said it to him three times. My grace is sufficient for you. Whatever state you are in this morning, God is saying to you, my grace is sufficient for you.
Hallelujah.
No excuse for not coming in with the message of God. My grace is sufficient.
Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you.
Listen, Jesus knows that some will reject. He knows that some will betray. But he still has a love, a depth of love, and he wants for you and I to call him friend. I wonder, will you let him come to that place of intimacy with you today? Will you let Jesus into your heart so that your heart beats with his heart?